Right, so Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so any questions before we start? First of all, I would like to make a couple of announcements. Apologies for the graph this last weekend. In the test. I tested it out on my machine. I could see the graph, but unfortunately, because of the write settings, you could not see the graph. So no part of the test will not be counting. So we'll only count question number one for test six as announced. This weekend, we will not have a test on this weekend, inshallah. But we shall have one covering chapter number four next weekend. Okay. This is quite an important chapter. And if you understand this chapter, then basically that you understand IP. And IP is at the core of all networks. So if you understand IP, you understand how IP addresses are distributed. You understand how routing takes place in the internet. Basically, you understand how the internet functions. So this is quite a key chapter in networking. Right, any questions before we start? Okay, so just to quickly outline, can you see the slides?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we're going to be talking about the network layer. And last time we didn't cover virtual circuits and datagram networks. We'll just go through that first. Then we'll cover what's inside a router and then go on to talk about the internet protocol or IP. Okay. Now, the network layer is responsible for delivering datagrams or packets hop by hop across the entire globe, across the world. So you've got different networks, and these networks are interconnected by routers. Routers connecting different autonomous systems are called border routers. And basically, on the sending side from the host, some application through the transport layer forwards the segment to transmit to the network layer. So on the sending side, you've got segments which are encapsulated into datagrams. And these datagrams are then sent hop by hop across different networks, forwarded through each one of these routers until they get to the correct destination. So you can imagine over here that what are the key problems over here? But the first problem is that of addressing. You need some mechanism of being able to globally address hosts in the entire world. And that is where the IP protocol addressing comes in. Secondly, each one of these routers over here will know or will have to know that once it receives an IP packet, based upon the destination address, where should I forward this packet to? Okay. So there's a local decision that has to be taken over here. And that is called the forwarding decision. That whenever a router receives a packet, it has to decide that which particular interface should it forward that particular packet to. Okay? And that's a local decision. That's the forwarding decision that takes place. Now, how is the forwarding decision done? Well, it's done through a table. So each router has to somehow build these tables, and that table will have an entry. And that entry will contain ki acha agar aapne is particular destination pe jana hai to yahan pe kis particular interface pe aapko next hop leni hai, theek hai? So somehow these tables have to be built, and the mechanism or the way these tables are built is through an exchange of information with peer routers, theek hai? And that is done through what is called a routing protocol. So routing is basically finding a path from source to destination, okay? And the routing protocol exchanges information between peer routers, And that information basically helps these routers build forwarding tables. And those forwarding tables are used for deciding a local decision ki acha agar is packet ne ultimately yahan jana hai to yahan pe is interface pe agle hop pe isko kahan jana hai. Theek hai ji? So what we see is at the end systems, you've got all layers, application, transport, network, all the way down to physical at both of the end systems. In between, in the routers, you only have up to the network layer. So in all of the intermediate routers, you don't have the transport app. Wo nahi hai. Wo sirf end systems mein hai. You still need the network layer. Why do you need the network layer in the intermediate systems? Well, the network layer is the one responsible for being able to forward packets globally. If you didn't have the network layer, if you didn't have IP addressing, if you didn't have addressing at the network layer, okay, these are local networks, these are islands. You would not be able to forward packets between these islands on a global scale. So the network layer provides that global IP addressing, that global scale addressing for you to be able to globally route your packets to any destination in the world. So when a packet is transmitted, it goes all the way down, and in each one of these intermediate routers, it arrives at the interface, on the physical interface, based upon the technology, you have a link layer interface, then the contents are stripped out, and the network layer के ऊपर आप आईपी एड्रेस को देख के उसको अगले हॉप पे फॉरवर्ड करते हैं एंड बेस्ड ऑन द टेक्नोलॉजी ऑन द नेक्स्ट हॉप यू एनकैप्सुलेट दैट आईपी पैकेट इनटू अ डेटा लिंक लेयर फ्रेम एंड फॉरवर्ड दैट ऑनटू द फिजिकल लेयर. ओके, सो फॉरवर्डिंग पैकेट्स एंड राउटिंग, जस्ट टू रिकैप वेरी क्विकली, फॉरवर्डिंग इज मूविंग पैकेट्स फ्रॉम द राउटर्स इनपुट टू द एप्रोप्रिएट राउटर्स आउटपुट. राउटिंग इज determining the route taken by packets from source to destination. Routing algorithms help to build forwarding tables, and routing is the process of planning the trip from source to destination, whereas forwarding is the decision that you take at a particular router at a single interchange. That is the forwarding decision. So the routing algorithm builds a forwarding table. Forwarding table, when you have entries which tell you that if your ultimate destination has this address, what is the next hop to take on the local router? So packet arrives, it has an ultimate destination, and the decision here is, acha is router ko mujhe 1 pe bhejna hai, 2 pe bhejna hai, 3 pe bhejna hai. So you'll have entries in a local forwarding table, which will match up potential destinations with output links over here. So notice आपके output links limited है, तीन हो सकते हैं, चार हो सकते हैं, पांच हो सकते हैं, आठ दस हो सकते हैं, बीस तीस हो सकते हैं, but they're going to be limited over here. Whereas these potential addresses can be any address in the world. IP addresses are 32 bit, which means that potentially you can have up to 4 billion entries in this table, and that is not a scalable thing to do. Therefore, you need some kind of aggregation or grouping of addresses, ki entire block of addresses ko aap ek hi entry se represent kare taki aapke paas ye cheez scalable ho, warna you'll have too many entries which will result in a longer lookup time which will result in more inefficiencies. Okay, now just very quickly we'll talk about virtual circuits and datagram networks for completeness, and these are two sort of possibilities that we have in the network layer. So what we've seen is that a datagram network provides either a connectionless service, theek hai, that is a hop by hop kind of a service jahan pe koi state maintain nahi ki jati in the intermediate routers, in the intermediate jo bhi aapke paas hosts ke darmiyan beech mein jitne bhi hops aayenge, at every hop you'll have a router which will determine the next hop, theek hai. And the router does not maintain any state, it's connectionless. So it has a table, it just looks at the address and forwards the address, just like the postal service. Each of the intermediate post offices just looks at a letter, reads the destination on the envelope, and based upon that decides ki acha isko next stop kahan bhejna hai. It's a connectionless service. Okay? Now, opposed to this, at the intermediate routers, you could also have a connection-oriented service. Okay? So that's the word we would like to use, a connection-oriented service. Okay? Now, what do we mean by a connection-oriented service? Connection-oriented, once again over here, would mean that the intermediate routers maintain some state. Okay? Now, just like if you remember, we talked about TCP-UDP connections, and we said TCP is connectionless, or it's connectionless, is that right? No, TCP is connection-oriented, UDP is connectionless. Okay? So TCP kya karta hai? That it maintains states, but it maintains states in the end host. What state does it maintain? It maintains things such as, acha, agar maine koi segment bhejni hai, to what should be my sequence number? Okay? It maintains that. It maintains windows. Acha, how many bytes am I allowed to transmit? How many have I transmitted? How many of them have been acknowledged? How many of them are in flight? How many of them am I still permitted to transmit? Okay? It maintains all of the state information on the end hosts. It maintains acha, connection ki state ke andar hai. Is it yani aapne SYN bhej diya hai, aap kisi wait state ke andar hai, aap finish one mein hai, finish two mein hai. It maintains all of that state information in the end systems. Okay? Now, in the network layer, then what you have is that agar aapke paas ek virtual circuit hai. Now, whenever you use the word circuit, think of this as an analogy to the telephone network. So telephone network mein aap kya karte hain? You dial, you set up a connection. So aap ek end host pe, ek telephone pe, ya ek mobile phone pe ek number dial karte hain. And jo hi aap number dial karte hain, ek end-to-end resources allocate kiye jate hain, reserve kiye jate hain for the duration of the call. Theek hai? That is circuit switching. Theek hai? Now, just like you have a circuit switch network where resources are dedicated end to end, analogous to that, in a virtual circuit, hoga ye ke resources dedicate nahi kiye jayenge, lekin aapke liye state maintain ki jayegi in the intermediate switches. That's why we call it a virtual circuit. So, although no physical resources are allocated end to end, what happens is that call setup is done. Which means that agar aainda packets aayenge belonging to that particular connection. So there is this idea of a connection. There is this idea of a flow that if packets belonging to a certain connection, belonging to a certain flow arrive, this is how we're going to forward them. So the intermediate routers maintain this information, and that's why we call it a virtual circuit. Virtual kyun kehte hain ke like a telephone network jahan pe aap physical resources ka matlab ye hai ki aapne ek switch ko hold up kar liya, theek hai, that switch is now busy, theek hai, a trunk is busy. A trunk is basically a line which connects one exchange to another exchange. A trunk is busy. So basically a wire, a switch, end to end aap resources allocate kar rahe hain, and they are using up, those resources are being held up for the entire duration of the call. जब आप कॉल को क्लोज करते हैं, when you put down the receiver, ठीक है, on either end, what that does is that it releases those resources for use by other people, by other circuits, ठीक है? So telephone network में resources are allocated end to end, and they're dedicated for the entire duration of the call. You're billed according to the duration of the call, and when you put your telephone down, when the call is completed, those resources are then released for use to other people. Okay? That's why you have a dedicated connection. That's why you have guarantees. That's why you have end-to-end delays and the guarantees. And that's why traditionally telephone networks are all, or were all circuit switched. Yahan pe aap kya kar rahe hain ki you're setting up a call, which means that some information is going to get exchanged end-to-end. And along the way, jo bhi path follow ho rahi hai, along that path, jo bhi intermediate routers hain, wahan pe state information maintain hogi. State information just means that although no physical resources are allocated, some state will be maintained that agar a flow belonging to a packet belonging to a particular flow arrives, to usko is tarike se yahan pe forward kar dena. So aap pehle se uska forwarding decision leke rakh lete hain, theek hai? And then when that actual packet arrives, you do a very quick decision on forwarding it without having to do a lookup on a very large table, jis pe time bhi lagta hai, and jo stateless hai, which means that every packet is treated independently, every datagram is treated independently. So you have two possibilities at the network layer. Ek ye ki datagrams ko aap forward kare without maintaining state. This is best effort. There are no guarantees of packet delivery because you're taking a local decision here. What happens subsequently, congestion ki wajah se packet drop ho jayega, kuch aur ho jayega. You can't guarantee any of that. Theek hai? And reliability, agar aapko build karni hai, that will have to build at higher layers, for example, at TCP end to end. Each of your datagrams is routed and switched individually. Theek hai? And datagrams belonging to the same application potentially can take different routes through the network, depending upon network traffic, if some particular path is busy, if you have a protocol which forwards packets based upon loads, okay, you could be taking different paths when for the same sort of TCP end-to-end connection ek hi hai, lekin along the network layer you could be taking different paths. For example if you had a particular link that got broken, or if a router went down, okay, so then the peer routers would detect ki acha ye jo particular router hai ye down ho gaya hai, and they will route around that, okay. So each datagram is forwarded hop by hop individually, and there is no maintenance of state ki acha ye jo datagram hai ye kisi flow ka hissa hai ya nahi hai. Routers ko nahi pata hoga, intermediate routers ko nahi pata hoga. End pe jo TCP hai wo hi hisab rakhega ki acha kaun se packets pahunch gaye hain, kaun se nahi pahunche, jo nahi pahunche wo retransmit kiye jaye. End to end aap ye reliability build karenge. In the network there is no information, there is no maintenance of state belonging to a particular flow. Opposed to this, theek hai, what you have is the virtual circuit. Virtual circuits mein different technologies istemal hoti hain, and examples of these, X25 was the oldest, uske baad frame relay aayi, uske baad ATM, uske baad MPLS. Now does anyone know what ATM stands for? Ji, ATM. Yeah, Hamza.
So if I'm not wrong, it's an automatic teller machine, right?
Automatic teller machine.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's the most common acronym for ATM, automatic teller machine. Lekin ye jo ATM hai, ye wo wala automatic teller machine nahi hai. This is the asynchronous transfer mode. Theek hai ji. So ye ek technology thi jo ke it's a very interesting technology which emerged in the late 80s, 90s ke through, and 2000s maybe, uske baad bhi abhi bhi it's still around. And it's the asynchronous transfer mode. Okay, now I'll just quickly type that out for you. Asynchronous transfer mode. Okay, this is what it is. ATM, asynchronous transfer mode. Now what do we mean by transfer mode? ठीक है, ट्रांसफर मोड क्या चीज है, व्हाट इज ट्रांसफर मोड? ठीक है, सो ट्रांसफर मोड इज बेसिकली योर मेथड ऑफ स्विचिंग. ठीक है जी, एंड फॉरवर्डिंग. स्विचिंग एंड फॉरवर्डिंग का जो तरीका है इन एनी नेटवर्क, दैट्स कॉल्ड योर ट्रांसफर मोड. सो एसिंक्रोनस ट्रांसफर मोड सिंपली मींस दैट you're switching and forwarding small sized cells, they're called cells in this technology. Theek hai, so packets ya cells, these are same. Cells, we use the word cells because they're smaller in size, theek hai, एंड ये जो ATM टेक्नोलॉजी में जो सेल्स थे ये थे 53 बाइट सेल्स थे विच आर वेरी स्मॉल. सो यू हैड ए 48 बाइट हेड पेलोड एंड अ 5 बाइट हेडर, जस्ट अ 5 बाइट हेडर. ठीक है, सो वेरी स्मॉल सेल्स. नाउ इसकी हिस्ट्री है, उसकी हिस्ट्री है कि इफ यू लुक एट टेलीफोन नेटवर्क्स, सो टेलीफोन नेटवर्क्स इवॉल्वड ओवर 100 ईयर्स and they culminated into digital telephone networks in the 70s, and then 80s ke andar digital telephone networks transformed into something called ISDN. theek hai, and ISDN kya cheez hai, that is basically integrated services digital networks. theek hai, now so you had the telephone network evolving separately. In parallel, you had these packet switch networks, which were used by, let's say, banks. They were used by airline reservation agencies and so on. They were used by rudimentary form between. You had different nodes exchanging packets. You had maybe email services. You had others. Such services, remote login ke liye kisi terminal ke andar, you had services which were based over IP. So you had other packet based networks and services evolving. So ek telephone network se which were circuit switched, aur ye packet networks se which were packet switched, and the idea was ke okay, these are going, and then you had telephone networks ke alawa you had television networks, broadcast networks. रेडियो था, ये सारी बाकी इस तरह के नेटवर्क्स थे विच वर प्राइमरली बेस्ड ऑन सॉर्ट ऑफ वायरलेस कम्युनिकेशन एज वेल एज लोकल ब्रॉडकास्ट के लिए यू हैड केबल नेटवर्क्स. ठीक है, सो द आइडिया वाज दैट वेल यू हैव गॉट डिफरेंट काइंड्स ऑफ नेटवर्क्स एंड डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ सर्विसेज, सम ऑफ देम आर टाइम सेंसिटिव, सम ऑफ देम आर नॉट, सम ऑफ देम आर लॉस सेंसिटिव, सम ऑफ देम आर नॉट. Some of them are delay sensitive, some of them are delay and time sensitive would mean the same thing. So we would want to build one network, theek hai, jo ki in sari cheezon, one digital network which would cater for all of these different kinds of services. And that was called an ISDN, Integrated Services Digital Network. And ye shuru mein jab aaya to initially you had a 2 megabits per second connection. ठीक है, एंड देन मल्टीपल्स ऑफ 32 किलोबिट्स और 64 किलोबिट्स सर्किट्स, एंड दे वर प्राइमरली यूज्ड फॉर थिंग्स लाइक फैक्सेस, एंड दे वर आल्सो यूज्ड फॉर थिंग्स सच एज वीडियो कॉन्फ्रेंसिंग पॉइंट टू पॉइंट. ठीक है, छोटा सा एक टर्मिनल होता था विद अ कैमरा, एंड यू हैड दिस डिवाइस व्हिच वाज डेडिकेटेड फॉर डूइंग वीडियो कॉन्फ्रेंसिंग. सो दैट वाज सॉर्ट ऑफ द प्राइम एप्लीकेशन ऑफ ISDN. एंड एज डिजिटल नेटवर्क्स इवॉल्वड थ्रू द 80s, then the concept of a broadband ISDN emerged. Theek hai, and broadband meant that any data rate which was 2 megabits per second at that time was called broadband. So then the question was ki acha broadband ISDN agar banana hai to uske liye transfer mode ya switching and forwarding mechanism kya kiya jaye. So it made sense to have a packet based network that gave you more flexibility. But then in order to guarantee that aapke packets jo hai na end to end ek certain deadline ke andar pahunch jaye, you had to make those packets small. That gave the concept of these small cells. Agar packets bade honge to unko switching mein, forwarding mein, queuing mein delay lagegi, and therefore you cannot guarantee end to end time limits. So that's why you had to make these packets small, and the 53 byte cell emerged. So this was all before the growth of the internet. Before the internet, the internet was born 89 May, as far as the technology, World Wide Web, that you can have these web pages and you can browse them, and that idea of being able to share information in the form of web pages came up in 89. Usse pehle networks the internet us form mein tha, but the World Wide Web as an application, yani wo 89 mein emerged hua, and then slowly these. The internet grew in the 90s as time, and that grew exponentially. So when that grew exponentially, then of course aapke paas web, the World Wide Web became the main application, and IP became the biggest sort of protocol that you required at the network layer, because in order to do this global routing and be able to sort of access web pages on a global scale, take IP became the driver. Now IP ke andar aapke paas, if you notice, jo datagrams hain, they're going to be typically of a larger size, 1500 bytes to 2000 bytes, or 1500 bytes is sort of the ballpark range. So agar aapne ek IP packet dalna hai into cells, of course you'll have to fragment that into very, very small sized cells. And that was a problem for sort of ATM, then evolving into MPLS, which was another in very, very interesting technology. So it's still the predominant technology. And this is multi-protocol. MPLS kya cheez hai ji, multi protocol label switching. Theek hai, so ATM then evolved into MPLS, and so ATM was a technology late 80s, early 90s, mid 90s, jiske andar a number of a lot of hard work, research was put into this, and it was a packet based technology which guaranteed sort of quality of service by setting up virtual circuits. And the way it did that was that you had a call setup mechanism, and just like telephone networks, you use from the source to the destination up node to node, ठीक है, एक call setup करते थे, where every node would know कि अच्छा currently मैं कितनी traffic carry कर रहा हूँ, can I admit another flow? So you had an entire process of call admission control, and उसकी basis के ऊपर, depending upon the requirements of this new user, you would calculate कि okay, can I accommodate this new user? If so, what virtual circuit number should I allocate to this? So you maintain state on a router to router basis, on a switch to switch basis, and these longer term connection usually between routers were maintained, and these intermediate nodes maintained state. Now you did not need to have a elaborate lookup, ठीक है, destination based forwarding उस तरह से आपको नहीं करनी पड़ती थी, because ये जो आपने virtual circuits define किए हुए थे, they were sort of predefined. Okay, so you had a much smaller table, you had a much smaller header, and you could think of this as a label or a tag, jiski basis ke upar you would switch very, very quickly. Okay, and but the cost was, of course, you had to pre-establish these circuits, you had to set up these circuits, virtual circuits between those ISP routers, and it was very, very reliable. X20FI was very reliable. ATM to a certain degree was also reliable, depending upon kis kism ki aap service lete hain. And then of course MPLS mein, which is called multi protocol label switching, what you did was that you had pre established routes which were called label switch paths or LSPs, and LSP is the MPLS equivalent to a virtual circuit. So ATM can carry IP traffic. And if you have a modem at home, and if you sort of configure that connection in many places, PTCL uses ATM even now, okay? So you will see something called VPI. You notice ki aapne configuring your home router ke andar VCI, VPI, is tarah ki cheez, which is called a virtual channel indicator, a virtual path indicator, where you're going to switch based upon these tags. These are simply tags, these are simply labels, ठीक है, जो कि एक particular flow को या एक particular user को identify कर रहे हैं, and you're doing that switching based on that particular tag, ठीक है. Now, so the question is that MPLS या ATM जो है, ये where do they fall in the networking stack? So if you were to map these to the networking stack, you could consider them as part of the networking stack, because in some way they are providing that addressing for you, okay, and they're providing a virtual circuit-based forwarding mechanism at the network layer. Or you could also think of them as a link layer technology, like us case ke andar. Link layer mein, of course, you have these ATM cells, which are then going to be carried upon some other mechanism. It could be a point-to-point, it could be some other technology like Sonnet or SDH or whatever. Isi tarah MPLSB is going to get encapsulated into some frame layer technology. But chunke switching isi ki upar ho rahi hai, theek hai? Therefore, it's a gray area, because end-to-end up switching agar virtual circuits ki upar kar rahe hai, and you're not using these IP addresses for that, so then of course this is your network layer. Whereas if you're using the IP address contained in the payload of these ATM cells or MPLS sort of packets, then of course you're using it purely as a layer two technology or a link layer technology. So virtual circuits may basically, it consists of a path which is from source to destination. Us path ko hop by hop aap identify karte hain through a virtual circuit number. So virtual circuit numbers are only valid for one hop, and they can change along the way. Theek hai? And you've got entries in forwarding tables jo map karte hain ki acha ye virtual circuit number entry pe kya hai aur ye kis pe map hoga at the outlet or of that particular switch. Theek hai? So packets belonging to virtual circuit, belonging to a particular flow, carry virtual circuit numbers rather than destination addresses. Theek hai? So ye sara kuch karne ke liye aapko call setup karni padti hai. Call setup karne ke liye aap ek alag protocol istemal karenge for setting up the call. Theek hai? You could set it up statically agar long term aapne rakhne hai ye connections. For example, let's say aapne Karachi aur Lahore ke darmiyan ek long term virtual circuit rakh chhodna hai. So any traffic which has to be routed from Lahore to Karachi will use that particular virtual circuit on those switches. Okay. And this number is only valid locally for one hop. So this can be changed on each link. So you have a new virtual circuit number that comes from the forwarding table. So these are your switches. Okay. These are virtual circuit switches. These are the interfaces. And aapke paas to identify a particular flow, aapke paas, these are virtual circuit numbers that you have. So for example, you could have an entry which says on an incoming interface, virtual circuit number 12 is going to go to outgoing interface 3, and aap is circuit number ko change kar denge to 22. So all incoming cells or labels jo 12 hai, they will get swapped to label 22, and your packets are going to get forwarded from interface 1 to interface 3. Okay? So iska matlab ye ki all, so you will have this entry in the table over here. कि अच्छा जी जो भी इनकमिंग वर्चुअल सर्किट नंबर 12 वाले हैं ऑन इंटरफेस 1 उनको आपने फॉरन से भेज देना है ऑन आउटगोइंग इंटरफेस 3 एंड यू गोइंग टू स्वैप द टैग टू 22 यू कैन थिंक ऑफ दिस एज ऑल पैकेट्स गोइंग टू कराची आपने लाहौर में ये फैसला किया कि हम उनको एक रेड टैग लगा देंगे ठीक है जल्दी के लिए सो जो भी पैकेट आएगा उस जिसको रेड टैग लगा होगा आपने उसको फॉरवर्ड कर देना टू कराची and maybe forward karte waqt uska tag change kar dena hai to a blue tag so that on the next hop it's identified as acha all traffic over here which has a blue tag is going to be forwarded onto the next hop which is now going to be a green tag theek hai so these circuit numbers can change and the circuit number identifies a flow end to end resources reserved nahi hote sirf ek table entry banayi jati hai ki acha virtual circuit number 12 pe agar कि अगर पैकेट्स आएंगे तो उनको फॉरवर्ड कर देना है टू इंटरफेस 3 एंड उनका सर्किट नंबर चेंज कर देना दैट दैट्स ऑल यू हैव सो द वर्चुअल सर्किट राउटर्स मेंटेन दिस कनेक्शन स्टेट इंफॉर्मेशन दैट्स व्हाई वी कॉल इट कनेक्शन बिकॉज यू आर मेंटेनिंग स्टेट इंफॉर्मेशन एट द इंटरमीडिएट राउटर्स सो दैट इज वन मेथड दैट यू कैन यूज इन द नेटवर्क लेयर अनदर मेथड दैट वी टॉक्ड अबाउट अर्लियर इज डेटाग्राम्स जहां पे आप कनेक्शन लेस फॉरवर्डिंग कर रहे हैं वहां पे आप कोई स्टेट मेंटेन नहीं कर रहे वहां पे बेस्ड अपॉन द डेस्टिनेशन अल्टीमेट डेस्टिनेशन एड्रेस आप एक टेबल को लुकअप करके ये डिसाइड कर रहे हैं कि अच्छा अगर आपने एंड पॉइंट ये डेस्टिनेशन जाना है तो इस जगह पे किस इंटरफेस पे आपको बाहर जाना होगा। सो पहले से कोई क्विक फॉरवर्डिंग लेबल टैग नहीं लगा हुआ जिसके ऊपर आप फॉरन से राउटिंग कर ले, आपको एक लुकअप टेबल देख के ही फैसला करना है एंड लुकअप टेबल बनेगा थ्रू दीज राउटिंग एल्गोरिथम्स। ओके क्वेश्चंस हियर, वी कवर्ड मेनी मेनी कॉन्सेप्ट्स एंड दीज आर समटाइम्स अ बिट स्टिकी, सो एनीथिंग अनक्लियर कि वर्चुअल सर्किट क्या है एंड स्टेट क्या है क्यों है एंड डेटाग्राम में कनेक्शन लेस का क्या मतलब है एंड इसको हम कनेक्शन ओरिएंटेड कह रहे हैं। कनेक्शन फिजिकल कनेक्शन तो मौजूद नहीं है लेकिन हमने एक वर्चुअल सर्किट बनाया है विच इज सिमिलर टू अ फिजिकल कनेक्शन। ओके सो वेरी गुड क्वेश्चन, व्हाई इज देयर नीड फॉर अ वर्चुअल सर्किट? देयर इज अ नीड फॉर अ वर्चुअल सर्किट फॉर एफिशिएंसी। ठीक है, सो इन दिस टेक्नोलॉजी अगर आप इसको कंपेयर करते हैं लेट्स से with the other datagram forwarding, तो datagram forwarding में आप destination addresses को map कर रहे हैं to an output link. Notice आपके पास output links थोड़े से हैं. Let's say ये router है, आपके पास तीन potential output links. एक input link यहाँ पे आ रहा है, ये तीन potential output links है. अगर आप 32 bit के IP addresses इस्तेमाल कर रहे हैं तो potentially 4 billion entries होंगी worst case में, अगर आप blocks नहीं बना रहे, which get mapped to either 1, 2, or 3. ठीक है, तो ये टेबल बनेगा पूरा राउटिंग एल्गोरिथम के थ्रू और फिर हर पोटेंशियल एड्रेस को आप मैप करेंगे टू इधर 1, 2, or 3। आउटपुट लिंक्स तो सिर्फ 3 ही है लेकिन इनपुट डेस्टिनेशन रेंज जो है ना वो 4 बिलियन है। सो अनलेस यू कैन सॉर्ट ऑफ समराइज दिस इन सम और एग्रीगेट दीज एड्रेसेस इन सम सेंसिबल वे, तो आपके पास मे बी थाउजेंड्स और मोर हंड्रेड्स ऑफ थाउजेंड्स ऑफ एंट्रीज होंगी इन योर फॉरवर्डिंग टेबल। As opposed to this virtual circuits में अगर using a protocol जो कि आपको एक connection setup कर देता है, connection setup करने का मतलब ये है कि intermediate routers पे ये equal entries डलवा देता है कि अगर इस particular source एक packet आएगा for this particular destination तो उसको हम इस hop के ऊपर ये circuit number या label number दे देते हैं एंड ये जब इस इंटरफेस पे आएगा तो इसको यहाँ पे फॉरवर्ड कर दो। तो नोटिस कि वो जो राउटिंग वाला काम है वो पहले हो गया ड्यूरिंग द कॉल सेटअप, कि अगर आपने यहाँ से यहाँ जाना है कैसे जाना है, सम अदर प्रोटोकॉल टेक्स केयर ऑफ कि आपने एंड टू एंड क्या पाथ लेनी है। वो जो पाथ लेनी है वो सारे पैकेट्स के लिए एक ही लेनी है। ठीक है, तो कनेक्शन लेस नहीं है, जो भी पैकेट आएगा वो उसी पाथ को फॉलो करेगा, आप उसी पाथ को चूंकि फॉलो कर रहे हैं दैट विल गारंटी दैट नो पैकेट अराइव्स आउट ऑफ ऑर्डर। Secondly, अगर आप उसमें reliability build in करते हैं कि आप router to router ये tracking कर रहे हैं जैसे X25 में होता है कि अगर ये packet अगले hop तक नहीं पहुंचा तो उसको retransmit किया जाए, ठीक है, that will guarantee कि packet पहुंचेगा, कोई packet घूमेगा भी नहीं। ठीक है, that's not done nowadays because prior 30 years ago these links were not reliable, they were wireless based and if you did that sort of provided that reliability hop by hop, then of course you would guarantee ki end-to-end cheez mil gayi. Now these networks are more reliable, fiber optic based hai, the probability of bit errors is much smaller. So rather than doing that checking every hop, you do that checking end-to-end. So if you provide these virtual circuits, theek hai, and these are basically entries in the table, so then if you label packets of that particular flow jo ki is destination ko jana hai by a small number, theek hai, to identify them, to tag them, to provide them a label, then of course these routers can very quickly switch that traffic to that particular destination. Theek hai, so is there a need to reroute with virtual circuits pre-established? There could be a need to reroute. So for example, if one of these links broke down or one of these routers failed along the way, okay, then of course you would have to route around that failure. Okay, and yeah, agar koi route jo hai wo zyada yani congest ho jata hai, so then you would need to route around that. And uske liye bhi there are entire protocols jo pehle se ये लोड बैलेंसिंग वगैरह कर रहे होते हैं एंड दे आर सॉर्ट ऑफ डूइंग ट्रैफिक इंजीनियरिंग फॉर अ लॉन्गर टर्म और फॉर अ शॉर्टर टर्म दे आर टेकिंग दोस ट्रैफिक डिसीजंस कि जी किस तरह से राउटिंग की जाए, किस तरह से वर्चुअल सर्किट्स को किया जाए. आपके पास प्राइमरी पाथ्स होंगे, कुछ बैकअप पाथ्स होंगे. इफ दिस फेल्स देन यू फॉल ओवर to a backup path and so on. So there are entire protocols which take care of that. So even if you have a virtual circuit, there could be a need to reroute, theek hai, as you suggest. And wo end to end jo hai wo reestablish nahi hoga, sirf entry change hongi and usse ye hoga ki aapka connection jo hai, jo end users hain unke liye wo that will be seamless. It'll be transparent, right? But over here, all we want to sort of highlight is कि दो तरीके हैं. एक ये कि stateless forwarding है of datagrams hop by hop to the destination. That's one way. That's connectionless. दूसरा ये कि you could have connection-oriented forwarding, which is based on the concept of virtual circuits. Why do we call them virtual circuits? Because physical resources end-to-end allocate नहीं किए जा रहे, जैसे कि circuit switch telephone networks में पहले किए जाते थे. We're not doing physical allocation of resources. We're only putting in state in the routers, which means that agar packet aaya to usko is tarike se forward karna hai. Agar nahi aaya to you're not holding up any resources. Theek hai? Notice ke when you hold up resources, agar aap baat kare ya na kare, jab aapne telephone dial kar diya, khamosh baithe rahe, no traffic is being carried, you're still being billed because end-to-end traffic resources are being held up. The switches are being held up, a channel is being held up, trunks are being held up, circuits are being held up. ठीक है, packet switching का advantage ये है कि आप end to end resources hold up नहीं कर रहे. जब packet आप बनाते हैं, data है आपके पास, you create a packet and you forward the packet. So you're only using up resources when you actually need them. So that's why it's particularly good for on-off kind of traffic, for traffic which is bursty in nature, on-off in nature, us kisam ki traffic ke liye, this is ideal because you don't want to hold up or hog the entire link, even though you're not actually generating any traffic. And that link can be multiplexed by other users, can be used by other users when you are not transmitting. And this gives the concept of a statistical multiplexing gain, which means that a common resource hai, jisko sare share kar rahe. So that's the advantage of packet switch networks. So you have a packet-based network, but still, because you have predefined virtual circuits, that if a packet comes, which this label is attached to, then you will forward it in this way. So essentially, you are treating that packet as a flow, as belonging to a flow, and all packets of that flow are forwarded, switched based on that entry, which is you're basically maintaining state, and this could be long term, or ye at the end of the connection you could tear down the state, which means ki ye entries in the intermediate routers aap khatam kar dete hain, and of course that virtual circuit number then can be used for some other flow. But think of this as a concept of a flow and elements belonging to that flow in a particular at a particular hop have these labels or tags which allow for very fast switching. Theek hai? And because they are maintained for the entire duration of that flow, all packets belonging to that flow will follow the same path and you will have no out of order packets received at the destination. And if you could do other things around this, you could do other sort of things such as call admission control or estimating bandwidth or other things. You can then even do more elaborate things such as guaranteeing end-to-end delays or ensuring that the probability of loss doesn't fall below a certain bound. And that gives you a quality of service, okay? Which is a very challenging concept in packet switch networks, that how do you guarantee a quality of service? But you can do that. And you see okay, nowadays, Zoom chalta hai, voice traffic by and large, if you have reasonable capacity available, so you although you can't guarantee, but you still get reasonable sort of quality of experience for the users. Okay, any questions? Virtual circuit forwarding versus datagram forwarding. Anything unclear over here? G. Okay, so that now takes us to this forwarding table. And suppose ye aapke paas destination addresses hain, 32-bit IP addresses hain, and there's this entire range of addresses and they map to link interface 0. This range maps to link interface 1, and this range here maps to link interface 2. And otherwise, you're saying that all other packets with a destination of whatever else is going to fall to destination link interface 3. Okay. Now, if you look at these ranges, so ye humne 8-8 bits ke andar char numbers ko likha hua hai. So it's like, think of them as 32 bits, but broken down into chunks of 8 bits each. Now, if I compare this range of addresses to this, so ye jo number hai aur ye jo number hai, it's the same number. ठीक है, ठीक है, इट्स 110010, ठीक है, एंड इफ यू वर टू डू दिस वेरी क्विकली, इट्स गोइंग टू बी, दिस आर 1s, 2s, 4s, 8, 8 प्लस 16 नहीं है, 32 नहीं है, 64, सो 8 प्लस 64 इज 72, 72 प्लस 128, ठीक है. So whatever that number is, 72 plus 128 is going to give you this number here. ये और ये एक ही number है, ये और ये एक number नहीं है. So if you notice कि इस range में यहाँ तक ये जो 8, 8 and 4, ये जो पहले 20 bits हैं इन दोनों numbers के, वो बराबर हैं, ठीक है? And then you've got zeros, all zeros से लेके ये, इनफैक्ट 21 बिट जो है ना बराबर है, एंड देन ये जो 3 और 8, 11 बिट्स जो है, ये ऑल जीरो से लेके ऑल वंस की रेंज ऑक्यूपाई करे. इफ यू लुक एट दीज नंबर्स हियर, तो यहां पे ये यहां तक, वंस अगेन यहां तक, द फर्स्ट हाउ मेनी बिट्स आर इक्विवेलेंट, द फर्स्ट 24 bits are equivalent, and then you have all zeros to all ones. And here, yahan tak, the first 21 bits once again are equivalent, and then you have all zeros to all ones. So you could write this number in some compact notation, and we'll get to that in a minute. But you have these entire ranges, theek hai? And the interesting thing is that, looked at those numbers again, theek hai? What you would see as common, 1010 yahan tak. So basically, yahan tak ye numbers common hai. Uske baad you have X's or all zeros se leke all one ki range. Theek hai? So this range over here, which maps to link interface 0, can be represented by this number over here. And ye jo aage ke 11 bits hai, they can be from all zeros to all ones. That's what makes up this range. Isi tarah, for the second one, you've got the first 24 bits common, and then these 8 bits over here can be from all zeros to all ones. In the third one, you've got this number over here, and you've got all zeros to all ones over here for this third link interface, which maps to link interface number 2. Okay? Any questions here? Is this clear कि ये आपने destination address range को जब आपने sort of summarize किया, तो basically I've put an asterisk over here, or you can think of this as an X over here. This is any bit value from all zeros to all ones is covered in this address range. Okay? Any questions here, Jim? Now, when we do a mapping of a particular address, ठीक है? Now notice कि ये address और ये address, इसमें यहाँ तक कि bits common है, ठीक है? So the question is that if you had something which mapped to more than one entry over here, तो फिर आप उसको किस particular interface से forward करेंगे? You would look for what is called the longest prefix match, which means that when looking for forwarding table entries for a given destination address, use the longest address prefix that matches the destination address. So if two of them match, to phir jisme zyada bits match karte hain usko aap istemal karenge. That's the rule that you're going to be following. Now let's take this example. ये एड्रेस आप लें डेस्टिनेशन एड्रेस ठीक है और ये बताइए कि विच पर्टिकुलर लिंक इंटरफेस डज दिस मैप टू जी एनीबडी
लिंक इंटरफेस जीरो
यस वेरी गुड नोटिस कि ये 10 ये 10 ये 11 है ये भी 11 है यहाँ तो इससे पहले हिसाब कुछ कॉमन है ठीक है यहाँ तक सो ये 1 भी कॉमन है उसके बाद ये दो 1s है ये 0 है सो दिस इज गोइंग टू मैप टू लिंक इंटरफेस 0 व्हाट अबाउट दिस वन जी यू हैव 11 हियर एंड 11 हियर सो दैट मैप्स टू उसके बाद ये 3 0s है इसके बाद ये Does this map match up? This is going to match up to which particular link interface?
Link interface 2.
Link interface 2. Very good. Link interface 2. What about this one? जी फुरकान सेज 1 ठीक है 11 एंड ये फिर ये जीरोस हैं ये जीरोस हैं और ये इसके साथ भी मैच करते हैं इट मैचेस टू बोथ 1 एंड 2 बट द लॉन्गेस्ट प्रीफिक्स मैच इज 1 बिकॉज इसके जो है आपके पास 24 बिट्स मैच अप कर रहे हैं वेयर एज इसमें आपके पास 21 बिट्स मैप अप कर रहे हैं ठीक है सो दिस इज गोइंग टू मैप टू लिंक इंटरफेस नंबर 1 बेस्ड अपॉन दिस लॉन्गेस्ट प्रीफिक्स मैचिंग रूल सो राउटिंग टेबल्स कैसे बनाएंगे द क्वेश्चन इज वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग बिकॉज यू आर गोइंग टू यूज एल्गोरिथम्स एंड प्रोटोकॉल्स एंड प्राइमरली यू आर गोइंग टू हैव सम इंफॉर्मेशन एक्सचेंज बिटवीन पीयर राउटर्स सो राउटर्स आर गोइंग टू एडवर्टाइज राउट्स कि जी मेरे थ्रू आई कैन गेट यू टू सो एंड सो एंड सो एड्रेस ठीक है सो राउटर्स के पीछे जो कुछ कनेक्टेड है वो दूसरी साइड के राउटर्स को अनाउंस करेंगे कि जी आप मेरे थ्रू फ्ला 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 जगह तक पहुंच सकते हैं एंड इसी तरह से हर राउटर अपने साथ जो कुछ कनेक्टेड है वो इंफॉर्मेशन एक्सचेंज करेगा एंड एज दैट इंफॉर्मेशन ट्रवर्सेस उसको एग्रीगेट भी करेगा ठीक है So that is how that information is going to percolate in the network, and you will have routing tables being built. So this information could be such as I can route you to so destinations. It could also say that I can route you to a certain destination at a certain cost. Now that cost could be anything. That cost could be अच्छा कितने hops में आप जा सकते हैं वहाँ तक. That cost could be a function of the actual cost you have to pay to the ISP. It could be a function of the bandwidth. It could be a function of some other things. So some arbitrary sort of notion for cost bhi aap iske saath associate kar sakte hain. And then based upon the costs to a particular destination, the routing algorithm could find the least cost path in order to come up with the entry. So agar multiple paths usko mil rahe hain, with different costs, so then it could come up with a least cost path to a particular destination. So the algorithm needs routing information, which is gathered by the protocol. It has to run on each network node, which is a router in this concept, in context, in each intermediate hop queue per each intermediate node, which are routers, they run karega. It has to find a suitable path from itself to the destination because packet aap tak pahunch gaya hai ab aapne packet ko khola हेडर पड़ा उसमें डेस्टिनेशन पड़ी सो यू नो कि इस पैकेट ने यहाँ जाना है सो देन यू नीड टू फाइंड एन एंट्री ठीक है फॉर कि अच्छा जी इस पैकेट ने अगर यहाँ जाना है तो इट नीड्स टू टेक अ सूटेबल पाथ बेस्ड अपॉन सम लीस्ट कॉस्ट फंक्शन और सम अदर क्राइटेरिया एंड देन बेस्ड अपॉन दैट इट यू हैव टू हैव दैट एंट्री क्रिएटेड इन द फॉरवर्डिंग टेबल इटसेल्फ एंड उस तक जाने के लिए यू नीड टू वर्क आउट व्हाट इज द नेक्स्ट हॉप व्हाट इज द इंटरफेस दैट यू हैव टू फॉरवर्ड दिस पर्टिकुलर पैकेट ऑन सो दैट इज हाउ यू गोइंग टू क्रिएट दीज टेबल्स एनी क्वेश्चन सो फार कि बेसिकली ये राउटिंग एल्गोरिथम ये फॉरवर्डिंग टेबल कैसे कंस्ट्रक्ट करता है ये एक्चुअल प्रोटोकॉल्स पे विल कम आफ्टरवर्ड्स वी विल टॉक अबाउट अ नंबर ऑफ प्रोटोकॉल्स व्हिच बिल्ड दीज टेबल्स फॉर यू कैसे बिल्ड करते हैं इंटरेस्टिंग एल्गोरिथम्स हैं बट बिफोर दैट वी विल कवर व्हाट इज इनसाइड ए राउटर सो एनी क्वेश्चन सो फार फॉरवर्डिंग के बारे में राउटिंग के बारे में लॉन्गेस्ट प्रीफिक्स मैचिंग के बारे में एनीथिंग अनक्लियर ओवर हियर Okay, so what's inside a router? We'll cover this very quickly. And if you think about it, you have input ports and output ports. So packets thrive on input ports, okay? And you'll need some high-speed switching fabric, which a packet ko kisi input port se kisi output port pe jaldi se pahuncha de. Okay, that's one high-speed switching fabric that you need. Then you need some route processing, which is going to create a forwarding table, ताकि आप header के basis के ऊपर ये decision कर सकें कि अच्छा इस packet ने किस particular output port पे जाना है. ठीक है. So you have to forward datagrams from incoming to outgoing links. Incoming से outgoing port पे आपने उसको forward करना है. And ये जो routing algorithm है which actually creates the forwarding table. Examples of this are these protocols over here. These are simply acronyms, okay? And we'll cover them, inshallah, subsequently. So that's the basic anatomy of a router, or the architecture of a router, okay? Now, this function of route processing, of management, or creating this forwarding table, that is called a management function, and we typically use the word a control plane function. Okay, it's managed in software. Okay, so you've got some software which does the which implements some routing algorithm. These are examples which exchange information with peer routers, जिससे आप ये forwarding table actually build करते हैं. Okay, and then in order to switch very quickly. ठीक है, you've got this forwarding or data plane, जिसपे आप hardware based क्यों? Because that's done very quickly, ठीक है, and software based क्यों? Because you might want flexibility, you might want to upgrade the software version that you have running over here or for that particular protocol with enhanced features and so on. So for that flexibility, this is typically implemented in software, whereas hardware के ऊपर you want to do very fast switching and the forwarding decision is done and so we call this function over here of forwarding the packets the data plane and we call this function of building the route building the forwarding tables through routing protocols as the control plane so forwarding plane and control plane ठीक है forwarding plane typically implemented in hardware And the control plane typically is implemented in software. So, जब आप forwarding tables बना लेते हैं, so for efficiency, what is done is that these forwarding tables are copied or pushed to the input ports, ताकि input port के ऊपर ही forwarding table मौजूद हो. जो ही packet आया, आपने जल्दी से lookup किया और decide किया किस particular output port पे जाना है, and then उस packet को output port पे forward किया जाता है through this high speed switching fabric. So internally, the input port interface में क्या होगा? आपके पास line termination होगी, physical bit level reception of bits. Notice that फ्रेम्स कंसिस्ट ऑफ बिट्स, तो आपके पास फ्रेम बिट्स की फॉर्म में आ रही होगी, वन्स एंड जीरोस की फॉर्म में आ रही होगी. सो यू हैव टू डू थिंग्स सच एज, अच्छा ये फ्रेम शुरू कहाँ से हुई, खत्म कहाँ पे हुई, दैट काइंड ऑफ सॉर्ट ऑफ डिलिनेशन विल हैव टू बी एस्टैब्लिश्ड बेस्ड अपॉन द फिजिकल लेयर. फिजिकल लेयर अगर क्लॉक बेस्ड है, सिंक्रोनस है, तो आपको उस लिहाज से चीजें करनी पड़ेंगी. अगर वो एसिंक्रोनस है, क्लॉक नहीं है वहां पे, तो फिर आपने फ्रेम का शुरू और आखिर और ये सारी चीजें डिटेक्ट करनी होगी. तो बेसिकली आपके पास एक फिजिकल लेयर इंटरफेस है जो कि सिग्नल्स को डिटेक्ट करेगा, उन सिग्नल्स को मैप करेगा इनटू वंस एंड जीरोस. वो वंस एंड जीरोस आपको एक फ्रेम देंगे जो कि किसी टेक्नोलॉजी के डिपेंडेंट, एक नेट से ईथरनेट है या डेटा लिंक लेयर के ऊपर बाकी टेक्नोलॉजीज है, वी विल टॉक अबाउट देम इन चैप्टर 5 नेक्स्ट चैप्टर में. So you will have received a frame, ठीक है. Now that frame, of course, Ethernet के अंदर भी there are different flavors, different data rates that you are using, different frequencies for the signals that you are using, and all of that. So that frame, उसमें से आप frame header जो है वो निकालेंगे, और उसका payload निकालेंगे, and based upon that payload, you're going to look at the IP address of the destination, which you're going to match using the forwarding table. And based upon that, आपने decide करना है कि जी इसको कैसे forward करना है, ठीक है. So एक चीज आपको line termination जो है, that is basically receiving bits on the physical level, उसको उन bits को आप convert करते हैं एक frame के अंदर, which is your link layer protocol पे आप पूरा frame receive कर रहे हैं. And in frame का जो payload है उसको आप lookup करके, उसके header को देख के आप ये decide कर रहे हैं कि अच्छा जी इसको अब हमने किस output port पे forward करना है. अगर आप उसको इमीडिएटली फॉरवर्ड नहीं कर सकते फॉर वट एवर रीजन, देन ऑफ कोर्स यू माइट हैव टू क्यू दैट. सो जो ही पैकेट्स आते जा रहे हैं इनको आप क्यू करते जा रहे हैं, ठीक है. एंड देन आप इनको वन बाय वन इनका हेडर लुकअप करके, डेस्टिनेशन लुकअप करके, यू आर गोइंग टू डिसाइड ऑन देयर अल्टीमेट डेस्टिनेशन, ठीक है. सो गिवन द डेटाग्राम डेस्टिनेशन, यू आर गोइंग टू लुकअप द आउटपुट पोर्ट यूजिंग अ फॉरवर्डिंग टेबल, एंड दिस इज ए This is a match plus action thing. Matching आप करेंगे table की entry के साथ, and then action करेंगे in terms of कि इसको आपने उस particular output port पे forward कर देना है. And the goal is to complete the input processing at line speed. Now why is that? Why is that a goal? कि अगर आप line speed पे, जिस speed के ऊपर नया frames आ रहे हैं, ठीक है, to that particular interface, if you can't process at line speed, तो फिर क्या होगा? What will happen? Why do we need to complete the input port processing at line speed? Ji. To avoid congestion. That's very good. So if you can't process that at line speed, to phir to yahan pe frames jo aayenge wo aate hi jayenge, and you can't process them forward, theek hai. Input processing aap complete hi nahi kar pa rahe us frame bana ke aur wahan pe. So this is going to build up to infinity. And it'll have a finite size. उसके बाद सारे frames जो आएंगे वो drop होते जाएंगे. So that's why the goal is to complete input processing at line speed, ताकि this queue doesn't build up because you're not processing this fast enough. अब even though you process it fast enough, you might still be held up because आगे चीजें फंसी हुई हैं, ठीक है. तो ये तो आपको करना ही करना है कि इसको line speed पे process करना है, link speed पे process करना है, ताकि things don't build up over here without other problems. But even if you do sort of process these packets at link speed, you can still have delays, you can still have holdups, theek hai. And switching fabric mein basically the idea is to transfer the packets from the input buffer to the output buffer, or aapko you have to process these packets at a switching rate, theek hai. And often this is going to be measured in terms of a multiple of the input output line rate. So agar aapke paas n inputs hain, to typically a switching rate of n times the line rate is desired, taki ek slot ke andar, theek hai, taki ek slot ke andar jitne bhi packets aa rahe hain, suppose you have n input ports, per slot a maximum of n packets can arrive there. If you could switch all n of them to the output port, suppose each one of them was destined to a different output port, ताकि there's no contention at the output ports, then if you could switch at n times the line rate, ठीक है, then no packet would be delayed due to यानी तो अगर output पे delays नहीं है, output buffer सारे खाली हैं, तो and you're switching to a unique destination, then as long as you can switch at n times the input rate, जितना work is coming at the input per slot, you can finish that. You have no queuing because you are not switching fast enough. So your switching fabric has to be at least n times the line rate. That is desirable because if you can achieve that, then of course you're not going to have any delays in your switching fabric. Now, three types of switching fabrics hain, historically, broadly speaking. Ek memory based hai, ek तो मेमोरी बेस्ड में बेसिकली व्हाट हैपेंस इज दैट ये जो पैकेट आया आपने यू हैव रिटन दिस टू सम मेमोरी एंड देन फ्रॉम सम मेमोरी लोकेशन यू हैव रिटन दैट आउट टू एन आउटपुट पोर्ट. बस बेस्ड में ये है कि यू हैव अ शेयर्ड बस बिटवीन द इनपुट पोर्ट्स एंड द आउटपुट पोर्ट एंड व्हेन दैट पैकेट इज टू बी स्विच्ड इट गोज थ्रू द बस एंड टू द आउटपुट पोर्ट. सो ऑफ कोर्स दिस बस इज अ शेयर्ड मीडियम सो ओनली वन पैकेट कैन बी स्विच्ड from a particular input port to an output port at a particular time. So this bus has to be a high speed bus, theek hai, operating at typically n times the line rates over here to be able to switch n packets per slot to respective output ports. Teesra ye hai ki aapke paas ek crossbar kisam ki cheez ho. Yahan pe you have physical switches and in parallel aap kisi bhi input पोर्ट को कनेक्ट कर सकते हैं टू एन आउटपुट पोर्ट इन पैरेलल, ठीक है, बाय क्लोजिंग द स्विच. सो दैट मींस दैट इवन दो इफ योर सॉर्ट ऑफ स्विचिंग रेट्स आर स्लोअर यू कैन अचीव ग्रेटर थ्रूपुट, ठीक है, बिकॉज दिस इज हैपनिंग इन पैरेलल. देयर इज नो शेयर्ड मीडियम, नो शेयर्ड मेमोरी और शेयर्ड बस व्हिच इज प्रोवाइडिंग द बॉटलनेक और अ कंटेंशन. सो क्रॉस बार स्विचेस आर ऑफ कोर्स the fastest switching fabrics that you have. So the first generation of routers, switching was done via memory, and basically when you had a packet arriving at the input port, you wrote that to memory, theek hai, and then using some DMA process or whatever, you then wrote from memory to the output port, theek hai. And of course here the speed is limited by the memory bandwidth, and because for every datagram that you were switching from the input to the output port, you had to cross memory twice. There were two bus crossings, ek to write to memory and secondly to write from memory to the output port. Theek hai, so the question here is, are collisions possible in crossbars? Theek hai, so if you've got two destined for the same output, yes, you can still have a collision over here. So if you have two packets destined for the same crossbar out for the same output port, theek hai, to usme bhi you can have collisions. So you'll have to manage that. Ke chale aapne is packet ko idhar forward kiya, usi time pe aap isko agar karenge to obviously you'll have a collision over here in the crossbar, theek hai. So you'll have to then you'll have to have this accelerated so that in half a time slot ye pehla पैकेट ट्रांसफर हो जाए, अगले हाफ में ये अगला पैकेट यहां पे ट्रांसफर हो जाए. ओके ओके, सो स्विचिंग वी हैव बस, यहां पे यू हैड इनपुट पोर्ट टू आउटपुट पोर्ट मैपिंग थ्रू ए बस, एंड ऑफ कोर्स द बस कंटेंशन वाज लिमिटेड बाय द बस बैंडविड्थ. And if you had, let's say, 32 gigabits per second bus, as for example in the Cisco 5600 series routers, then you could easily handle link rates or line rates of up to a gigabit per second and so on, which were pretty fast in their day. And isi tarah se, to overcome bus bandwidth limitations, you've got different architectures of these interconnect switching networks, crossbars hain, banyans hain, different kisam ke networks have evolved over time, which were initially researched into connecting different processors to multiprocessors usse rise hue, and Cisco 12000 series routers where, for example, you have a 60 gigabits per second interconnection network of crossbars, which uses fixed size cells. So to accelerate things, our packets go fragment karte hain into smaller fixed size cells, and then you switch cells through a fabric. So that achieves a much, much greater throughput. So over here, it's a very high level view. Memory, buses, and crossbar architectures or interconnect architectures are three sort of generations of how routing technologies have evolved over the last 30 years, 25 years or so. Okay. Now, once you cross the switching fabric, then of course you will connect to the output port. Output port, once again, based upon the link layer technology, it could be entirely different technology from the input port technology. आपने उसको दोबारा से पैकेट को बफर करना है, ठीक है, and then forward करना है to a link layer protocol technology, and then that's going to convert your frames into bits, which are going to be actually transmitted on the line, on the physical interface. This could be a wireless interface, it could be a fiber optic interface, it could be a copper based DSL kind of a link. To ye sara ke sara line termination pe aap us frame ko ones and zeros mein dobara convert karke you will be transmitting that. So buffering is required when datagrams arrive from the fabric, which is faster than the transmission rate. So typically switching fabrics, humne kaha ke if you have n inlets, so n times the input line rate pe aap switch kar rahe honge, which is going to be faster than the output line rate as well, because input output line rates will be similar, ek hi honge. So therefore switching fabrics work faster than the line rate that you have, so you will need some buffering of whatever packet that is being forwarded from the switching fabric before it can be transmitted onto the line. So yahan pe do cheeze hai, ek buffering hai, और फिर आपके पास लेट्स से मल्टीपल पैकेट्स यहाँ पे बफर्ड है इन द क्यू ओवर हियर. सो यू कुड हैव स्केड्यूलिंग डिसिप्लिन्स व्हिच आर इंटरेस्टिंग, दैट इफ दीज पैकेट्स हैव डिफरेंट प्रायोरिटीज, यू माइट चूज टू ट्रांसमिट सम पैकेट व्हिच हैज अ हायर प्रायोरिटी अर्लियर देन द अदर पैकेट्स. सो व्हेनेवर यू हैव आर टू गारंटी क्वालिटी ऑफ सर्विस, सो दैट काइंड ऑफ थिंग हैपेंस, कि आप कुछ पैकेट्स को बाद में फॉरवर्ड करेंगे ऑन द लिंक, कुछ को पहले करेंगे बेस्ड ऑन प्रायोरिटी. सो यू हैव स्केड्यूलिंग डिसिप्लिन्स अमंगस्ट द क्यू डेटाग्राम्स फॉर ट्रांसमिशन, व्हिच डिटरमिन कि किस ऑर्डर में इन्होंने लाइन पे जाना है. सो यू कुड हैव फर्स्ट इन फर्स्ट आउट, व्हिच वुड बी इन दैट व्हाटएवर कम्स इन फर्स्ट इज ट्रांसमिटेड फर्स्ट ऑन द लाइन. यू कुड हैव अदर मैकेनिज्म्स बेस्ड अपॉन प्रायोरिटीज. So you could have some kind of a weighted fair queuing protocol, which depending upon the priority, you have a higher weight for certain packets, and based upon that, उनको आप पहले जो है transmit कर रहे हैं onto the line. Okay, so any questions here switching fabric के बारे में and output ports के बारे में? So packets will be lost due to congestion or a lack of buffer space, typically at the output, or even based upon the architecture of the router, wherever you have these buffers. And priority scheduling refers to who gets the best performance, and one of the goals might be network neutrality, where you would want to ensure an equal a capacity or share bandwidth share for all users. But whenever you are going to have priority, then of course kisi ko aap prioritize karenge to koi suffer karega, and that's how things work. Now output port queuing mein at time t, suppose you've got more packets arriving from the input, theek hai, to the output. Okay, so So yahan pe aap dekhen ki you've got this packet here, which is destined for this output port. And usi time slot ke andar aapke paas ye packet hai, which is also destined to this particular output port. Theek hai? So you've got more packets from the input to the output. Theek hai? So you need buffering whenever the arrival rate with the speed where the switch exceeds the output line rate. So suppose output line rate mein you can transmit one packet per slot over here. So ab ye do switch ho rahe hain yahan pe. So even if you could switch two of them, theek hai, within that same time slot, ye dono aapne switch kar diye ikatthe, aap inko aage line pe nahi bhej sakte. Therefore you need buffering capacity over here to hold these two packets over here simultaneously, because both of them are destined for the same output port. So think of this as a slotted system. Har slot mein ek packet aap process kar sakte hain. Is given slot mein ye do packets red wale isi particular output port ko destined hain. Even if you could switch fast enough and move both of these in the same time slot to the output, you will need buffering here, because ये जो आउटपुट पोर्ट है ये वन पैकेट पर स्लॉट ही आउटपुट पे भेज सकती है. ठीक है, सो यू नीड बफरिंग एट द आउटपुट पोर्ट ओवर हियर टू बफर बोथ ऑफ दीज एंड देन ट्रांसमिट वन आउट इन ए गिवन टाइम स्लॉट. ठीक है, सो वन पैकेट टाइम स्लॉट लेटर ये दो इधर पहुंच गए, ये ब्लू वाला इधर पहुंच गया एंड ये ग्रीन वाला यहाँ पे आ गया एंड ये पिछला वाला रेड वाला इस क्यूड ओवर हियर. Okay. Now, if this output port had a fixed capacity, let's say its capacity 2 hai, theek hai, and agle slot mein mazid 2 aa jate hain yahan pe, theek hai, and agle slot mein aap ek ko move kar sakte hain bahar, ek yahan pada hua hai, 2 mazid aa gaye hain, to un 2 mein se sirf ek ko yahan aap queue kar sakte hain, ek drop ho jayega. Theek hai, so you'll have loss due to output buffer overflow. Okay, you also have a queuing delay over here, because although ye switch karke aapne yahan pe buffer kar diya hai, ye aap foran se output line pe nahi bhej sakte. This packet will have to wait for one packet slot, so it will have to wait for that transmission delay before it can be transmitted on this line. So you have a queuing delay because of this output buffer. You will also potentially have a loss at the output buffer if it overflows. Okay, so any questions over here on output port queuing? This is the case where you can move, you have a very fast switch fabric and you can move all of the packets destined to a single port, unko aap within that time slot move kar pate hain. You can still move them. And the question arises is that how much buffering do you actually need? Theek hai? And the answer, of course, is that as a rule of thumb, you would require typically jo round trip transmission time aapka hai, that times the link capacity. So if your link capacity was 10 gigabits per second and your round trip time was 250 milliseconds for that particular next hop, I won't say next hop for a round trip time. So aapko itni capacity chahiye hai. As a rule of thumb, this is an RFC which suggests this, and more recently it's been recommended to have a slightly smaller buffer size based upon the number of flows that you have. Okay, so any questions over here? We'll stop over here. Any questions regarding buffering as well as the switch architecture? Okay. We'll talk about input port queuing inshallah next time, and then move on to the IP protocol. Okay, so thank you very much. If there are no questions, any questions? Okay, no questions. Okay, good office. Good office. No questions, ji. Okay. Okay, that's it for today, then, inshallah. Khuda hafiz.